The Jerry Powell Podcast is brought to you by Archstone Foundation, preparing society and meeting the needs of an aging population. And now, here are your hosts.
Welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast. This is Eric Wadera.
This is Alex Smith.
And Alex, who's with us today?
Today, we are delighted to be joined by incredibly prolific young writer, cardiologist. This is Heather Vereich, who is Associate Director of the Heart Failure Service at the Boston VA and Associate Physician at the Brigham and Women's Hospital. He has two books about heart failure. The first one is Modern Death. It has a longer title and it's more palliative care focused. We're going to focus a little bit more on the second one, which is titled State of the Heart, Exploring the History, Science, and Future of Cardiac Disease. Welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast, Heather.
Thank you so much. It's truly, I know it's overused, but it's truly an honor to be on this podcast with you, Eric, and Anne.
Thank you. Anne is our other guest, Anne Rolfing. She is a palliative care fellow at UCSF. And last year, she worked on the Advanced Heart Failure Service as a hospitalist at UCSF. Welcome to the Jerry Powell Podcast, Anne.
Thank you, guys. So excited to be here.
So we're going to be talking about palliative care and heart failure and a little bit about what you've talked in your books and your numerous publications. But before we do, we always go into a song request. You have a song request for Alex.
I do. And this is a song I grew up listening to a lot when I was in Pakistan, which is where I went to med school as well. And this is a song by the band Junoon. And the song is called Buleya.
And there's a wonderful Moth episode where the, what was it, the name of the lead singer?
Salman Ahmed.
Oh, incredible story about how he went. He grew up in part in the United States, went to a Led Zeppelin concert, got inspired to play, went back to Pakistan and was, playing guitar there, had an encounter with the Taliban who cracked his guitar, and then went on to form this band, Junoon, which was like the most best-selling band of all time in Southeast Asia or something like that at one point.
And he's a physician, right?
He is a physician. And I met him briefly when I was at med school. And when I met him, I told him I write. And he said, oh, here's another confused med student.
Like him. That's funny. Okay, here we go. A little bit of Buleya.
Buleya ki jana main kaam, Buleya ki jana main kaam, no my moment which my seat.
I'm gonna stop there.
That was amazing. Thank you.
How close did Alex get to actually saying those words correctly?
The Pakistani.
It was pretty good. I mean, the music is great. I love it.
I love that. There's so many good things about that song. He starts off with these chords, which are kind of like Sufi mystic on guitar. And then he goes into this funk, like this chord here. That's James Brown. I love it. It's great.
I still remember where I was when I heard this song. I was, driving with my brother and my dad early in the morning. We heard this song for the first time, just 7 in the morning. We were going to attend this event, and it still stuck with me. And essentially, it is the story of this Sufi mystic who's now essentially reached some sort of, existential crisis, where he's speaking to his Lord and Savior, and he's completely lost between the real world and this sort of spiritual world that he exists in. And the song's always resonated with me. So that's one of the reasons why I picked it. The other was just to have you sing in Urdu, which is great.
Well, thank you. Let's dive into this topic for today. Anne, do you want to kick us off with some questions?
Yeah, sure. Well, thanks again so much for being on and for having me as well. I just wanted to start off by asking how you got interested in the overlap of the fields of palliative care and heart failure, specifically with your advanced heart failure training? I just start off there.
Sure. You know, as a, you know, when I was in residency, I was, you know, I went to the Beth Israel, which is really, if you're someone who's interested in palliative care and having a thoughtful approach to taking care of patients, I can't think of a better place to train in. And, you know, one of the things I was struck by was that patients, there was this one particular case I remember, and it was a an older woman who had hypertrophic cardiomyopathy, and she was undergoing this high-risk procedure, and she didn't end up having a good outcome. And I felt that I had, you know, personally failed her, because even though we had planned for, you know, what would happen if this goes well, I always felt like I never, you know, mentally prepared her to think about, well, what if things don't go to plan? What if, you know, what are sort of other things that might happen? And I personally felt like I had failed her. But when I looked beyond that case, I felt that that was, you know, in some ways not, I don't want to say emblematic, but I said it was very prevalent in patients who had advanced heart disease, that a lot of times we didn't have palliative care integration the way that we had for patients with oncology. And I was drawn to both of these fields. In fact, after residency, I worked for a year as an oncology hospitalist because I love taking care of patients with cancer so much. And so this initially began as a clinical interest, but then kind of blossomed into a research interest as well, where I started to more formally study some of the gaps in the care that patients with advanced cardiovascular disease experience, especially as they approach the end of life.
Just to elaborate further on what some of those gaps are for our listeners.
Sure. You know, I think if you look at, there is gaps that you'll all, you know, see, you know, perhaps at the bedside. But, you know, if you look at the data, we know that patients with cardiovascular disease are, in fact, the least likely amongst all major diseases to die at home, which, you know, again, may not be the preferred site for everyone. But certainly, if you survey patients, most patients would like to be able to die at home. We know that palliative care referrals are put in less frequently for patients with cardiovascular disease. And when they are placed, they're placed very late during their trajectory. And eventually, when these patients have, you know, are being discharged to hospice, that's when really some of these gaps become very, very clear. So we, one study we performed that was published in JAMA Cardiology showed that the median survival of heart failure patients discharged to hospice is only about 11 days, and that's much shorter than that for cancer. And of these patients, about a third of them actually die within the first 3 days of being discharged. So many patients are being, even when we identify patients as being some patients who might benefit from being discharged to hospice, we know that that decision is being made very late.
And why then do you think that is? Why is heart failure different than these other diseases?
Great question. And I feel like, you know, part of it is that there's a cultural issue, I think, amongst cardiologists and everyone else who takes care of these patients, that, you know, we don't necessarily think of engaging in either primary palliative care or secondary palliative care when it comes to taking care of these patients. Many of these patients don't have, you know, a clear inflection point, if you may, where, for example, you know, just starting from diagnosis to sort of more further along in their natural history, prognostication can be very, very difficult in these patients. So a lot of times, and we've shown this in one of the first projects that I did, was in fact looking at this specific question of how good are physicians at assessing or estimating prognosis in patients with heart failure. And, you know, we found essentially that physicians really across the spectrum of training are not very good at getting a sense of how sick or how, you know, how much time a patient with heart failure might have, and that having more experience as a clinician actually doesn't really change that. So whether you're a heart failure cardiologist or whether you're an intern, you are essentially as likely to be wrong or right about a patient with heart failure when it comes to assessing prognosis. So I think that's really sort of critical to why I think really, we both underuse palliative care and hospice in patients with heart failure, and that when we do, we don't use it well.
Yeah, you said several striking things already. I just want to highlight for our listeners, in case they missed it, people with heart failure discharged from the hospital to hospice have shorter lengths of stay than people with cancer in hospice. Is that right?
That is absolutely right.
That is concerning. It strikes me that maybe where we are as a field with heart failure, where we were with oncology, I don't know, 15, 20 years ago, and we have some ground to make up.
That's certainly what, you know, looking at the data and then also culturally, I would completely agree with you that we're at least, you know, 15 to 20 years behind integrating palliative care and palliative care concepts in the care of patients with advanced heart disease, as we are to cancer.
And I wanted to get back to one of the points that you had brought up too, as well, in thinking about the culture, is what you mentioned of, culture in cardiology of referrals to palliative care, and thinking about just understanding from your point of view as a cardiologist, what that culture is currently like.
Well, what I'll say is that the culture of cardiology can change from institution to institution. I have, you know, moved. I was in a different place for med school, for residency, for fellowship, and now as faculty. And I will say that I've seen variation even within my own sort of N of one experience from one place to another. I will say that, for example, right now I'm at Brigham and Women's and at the VA, and at the Brigham we have an integrated heart failure palliative care service called HeartPal. And this is a service that is dedicated for patients with chronic heart failure, and we work very closely with them. We will co-round with them. And I feel like that level of integration I've not seen anywhere else. And then there are other places that I worked with where really you couldn't, I've not been out of training for long. I was a fellow until last year. And as a trainee, you could not get a palliative care consult without essentially having approval from the entire sort of chain of command, if you may. And so there is different levels of integration across communities, but if you look at the national data, it would suggest that by and large, you're essentially using palliative care as Tony Bach recently said, a brink of death consult, if you may, that by the time someone thinks that, oh, this patient is seriously ill, they may benefit from having, you know, a palliative care consultation, we're so far down and so close to the patient being close to the end of life that I worry that they don't get the, you know, real benefit of having that additional service.
So I got a question. You know, there's an adage like really good heart failure symptom management is really good heart failure management. Like, what does that additional palliative care consult add to really good, you know, symptom management focused on their heart failure by the cardiology team?
So, fantastic question. And I think that it just goes to show how heart failure and cancer are in some ways different. So, you know, if I'm a heart failure cardiologist or any heart failure cardiologist, when you go to a patient's bedside, the first thing you ask them is, well, how are you feeling? And how, and really, other than, I would say, in ICD, most things that we do in heart failure are focused on helping people both live longer and feel better. So, which may not be true for, you know, other therapeutic areas in which you may get a treatment that may make you feel poorly, but may help you live longer. So there's that one sort of specific difference. Having said that, if you look at most sort of large studies, you know, dyspnea is not the only symptom that many patients with heart failure experience. If you, you know, depending on who you ask or what study you look at, you know, patients with heart failure have a wide array of symptoms beyond just, I can't breathe, or I feel like an elephant is sitting on my chest. And I feel like that's where some of our blind spots may in fact lie, where even though as a heart failure cardiologist, I might be very focused on the patient's heart failure, I might be very focused on their volume status, but you know, again, that my training may make me very adept at managing those symptoms, but there may be a lot that I may be not even asking my patients, not even addressing, and not frankly be trained well to sort of take care of. You know, but I think what you're indicating and what your question sort of shows is that we still have more to understand about what is the value add of palliative care in a patient with advanced heart failure as opposed to cancer. And as much as I feel and I truly believe that there's a significant value add, what that specifically means, I think, is an area that we really need to study further.
I just wanted to get back to one thing you mentioned, which is thinking about your training in that, and that, you know, that's training in those other symptom needs and thinking about other questions that as a training in cardiology and advanced heart failure is not something that's brought up. And one of the things that I had really liked in your article with Dan Meyer was thinking about how, I think the quote exactly was, education in palliative care could be mandated for cardiologists, and thinking about the demand, the number of patients with heart failure, the number of patients who need who have palliative care needs far exceeds the number of palliative care specialists. So how do we sort of narrow that gap, and how do we train cardiologists in palliative care as well?
And just to note for our listeners, you're talking about Hedder's New England Journal perspective with Diane Meyer about heart failure and palliative care.
So I think that that's really an area where we can really make a high impact. And I think that's where, you know, people like myself, people who are, you know, passionate about this field, but are not necessarily sort of experts in, you know, serious illness communication the way palliative care physicians are, I think partnerships there are extremely important. And there are places that have integrated sort of more sort of palliative care and communication skills into their training. So, you know, again, you know, at Brigham and Women's, for example, all the fellows and I believe all the faculty get dedicated training by our palliative care specialists in communication. But if I'm right, I think that's the only program that I know of that specifically mandates that as part of their curriculum.
And certainly, I should say that's new. I trained there. I did internal medicine residency, did palliative medicine fellowship there, 2002 to 2006. And none of this existed. So this shows you that we can change and we can build these services that are, you know, co-managing, integrated, HeartPal, you know, brand new service. If we have the will and the resources and the, you know, culture shift to do it.
And I think part of that culture shift is being, you know, it's not coming from the top down, it's coming from the bottom up, because now you have a lot of, you know, people, residents who trained in internal medicine and who got just great, fantastic palliative care experiences, who are now becoming cardiology fellows, who are now, you know, beginning to graduate and become faculty members. And they're looking at their field and thinking about, geez, this is very different from, this is a field that is really ripe for innovation. And, you know, I'll just, and it shows how much, you know, even a few individuals can make a difference. I will say that at a place like, for example, the Brigham, you know, we have a, you know, fellow who is to finish cardiology fellowship, is now doing a palliative care fellowship, and is doing advanced heart failure fellowship next year. And this mandated training was actually, you know, she's spearheading it, you know, as a fellow. So it goes to show that, you know, even though it may feel like, oh, we're decades behind, you know, we can really make a difference. And if we make the right pitch, I think people in leadership positions are now much more open, even within cardiology, which, you know, is still not there yet, to accepting more patient-centered ways of taking care of their patients. So I'm very, very encouraged that we will continue to see a change. And the change is going to come from some of our most, from our newest fellows, from some of our youngest faculty members.
How do you talk about palliative care when you talk about it with your trainees and with your fellow cardiologists?
You know, one of the things that I say is that if you look at, for example, on advanced heart failure, so if you go to a congestive heart failure service, you know, we'll have a census of about 16, 17 patients. And, you know, for most of them, what we are essentially doing is we're providing palliative and supportive care. We just don't call it that. If you go to a heart failure service, for the most, you know, let's say you have a census of 16 or 17 patients, most of the patients on that service will not be candidates for an advanced heart failure therapy, such as a heart transplant or an LVAD. And you can, and then of those patients, many may not be patients who can tolerate your usual heart failure medications. Many patients we are starting on inotropes essentially as a pure palliative therapy. So, you know, what I tell others is that a lot of what we do in routine advanced heart failure care is palliative care. We just don't call it that. And because we don't call it that, we don't think about it with intention. We don't think about, well, how can we get better at this? And so one of the things that I do is really to just open people's eyes so that they start thinking about, well, geez, this is a big part of what we do. This is not a niche sort of field. Whenever, you know, I introduce myself and I tell people that, oh, I'm interested in heart failure at the intersection of heart failure and palliative care, many people will say, oh, that's a great niche. And I said, no, this is actually most of what we do. And I think, so first of all, I try and sort of sensitize people to the fact that this is a big part of our jobs. And that if you are going to be a good cardiologist, if you want to take pride in yourself as a good cardiologist or heart failure doctor, this has to be a really sort of central part of what you do. And really some of the best you know, palliative care, primary palliative care, I've seen is delivered by advanced heart failure doctors, even though they may not necessarily think of themselves as, you know, that this is what this is the main part of what they do. So I think part of how I introduce this is by removing this notion that palliative care is only for a subset of patients who are essentially at the end of life or within the last few days or weeks of life, but really try and extend that to really a large proportion of the patients that we see and the work that we do.
I was going to ask, this may take us down an enormous rabbit hole, so we don't have to go here, but I was going to ask if you think that hospice is a good model for people with heart failure. Like, is part of the reason that people are discharged from the hospital to hospice so close to death, or that they enroll in hospice so close to death, because hospice isn't designed fundamentally to meet the needs of people with heart failure?
I would have to agree with you, and it may not just be hospice, but how we use it, but certainly, you know, the way I think about this is that if we keep using, you know, prognosis, for example, as an entry point to hospice, if the whole idea of hospice is that, oh, when you can confidently say that someone has limited prognosis, then you enter into hospice, I would think that will not work. The other issue with hospice is that I think hospice works if you have some type of outlet for exacerbation. So, you know, if you have a model in which you can allow concurrent therapy, so if you can allow, you know, provision of IV diuresis or some type of, you know, intermittent escalation so that you can stabilize patients and keep them there, I think it's a model that will work better. I think this idea that, you know, once you go to hospice and, oh, if you need, you know, then if you sort of have a heart failure exacerbation, you know, you either have to continue in hospice and do the best you can with whatever options you have, or you have to essentially, you know, disenroll from hospice, come back to the hospital. And we see a ton of that. I see a ton of patients. I saw this just 2 weeks ago. We had a patient with end-stage heart failure. We spent more time on that patient than any of our other patients on service, because it's such a difficult decision. Patient eventually went to home hospice, was back after a week in the hospital getting IV diuresis. So, you know, the way I think about this is that I think hospice serves a lot of our patients very well. But if you look, and we had this recent paper in JPSM in which we looked at how, you know, proportion of patients with specific disease states and how many of them died in hospice facility. So you could argue that hospice facility might actually be better for heart failure patients because you can provide more intensive treatments there. I want to say that 10 most common causes of death, patients with cardiovascular disease were the least likely to die even in a hospice facility. So no matter how you look at it, the current system is just, for whatever reason, for a multitude of reasons, is just not meeting the needs that these patients have. So I definitely think this is an area that is ripe for disruptive innovation.
So how much of that is, I mean, we talk about the needs, you know, to train cardiologists around palliative care. How much of it is the need to train palliative care providers, hospice providers, on how to take care of hospice patients at home or in these facilities? For example, you don't see a lot of, you know, people getting a lot more aggressive with oral heart failure medicines or switching from like furosemide to something else. Is there that need for some kind of cross-cultural teaching?
I think there's a huge need, and I think that unless we start partnering with the different sort of specialists and clinicians who are part of the ecosystem of these patients, we'll just never know. I mean, I'll give you a small example. I did a small survey of hospice nurses in North Carolina, which is where I was at that point, and most of them, and I asked them a question. Part of that survey was getting to that exact same, you know, question that you asked: how comfortable are, say, hospice nurses, for example, in that case, comfortable taking care of patients with heart failure? So the first question I asked them was, what are the most common symptoms that your heart failure patients have? And the distribution was very similar to what you would see or expect. Fatigue was up there, dyspnea was up there. And then we reframed the question and we said, well, what are the most challenging symptoms that these patients have? And then there was a whole different distribution. Ascites showed up and I was very confused. I was like, wow, I never thought that this would be so commonly seen as a challenging symptom amongst heart failure patients, even though, you know, now in retrospect makes sense. Confusion came up, anxiety came up. And even though, you know, when we asked them, are you comfortable, you know, with diuresis, most people said yes. But I think in practice, we know that I'm not sure if we're getting the most bang for our buck when it comes to just simple heart failure therapies. And so I completely agree with you. I think unless we don't have these sort of partnerships between the heart failure community and the hospice community and the palliative care community and really everyone, there'll be big misses that we'll make. There will be rooms for improvement.
When I think about these patients too, I think there's that, you know, that room for improvement with, these are just patients with end stage regular heart failure who aren't even getting the advanced therapies that we're talking about. And so thinking about that growing population as well of patients who are getting, you know, destination therapy, LVADs, and what does their care look like and what does their end of life care look like? Trying to better understand that and, like, you know, like, what would you explain to a hospice provider? I mean, not all hospices can take LVADs even to begin with, but Yep. What, you know, what would your, you know, I wrote some articles about top tips, but your top tips for listeners about thinking about those folks who have LVADs?
Yeah, so LVADs are, you know, as far as LVADs are concerned, it's just such an, it's one of the most extreme medical inventions we've ever come up with, right? I mean, this thing is unlike anything else. And I will say that there are, the vast majority of patients with LVADs still die in the hospital, unfortunately. And you might argue that that may not be such a bad thing. This is an intervention, you know, as soon as you know, this is an intervention that is highly complex. As soon as you turn off an LVAD, essentially all the medications in your, you know, bloodstream might stop circulating. So you may have to pre-medicate. If the decision is to stop an LVAD in a patient before they pass away, you may have to, home may not be the right place for that type of patient. But, you know, one of the things that I feel, and this is, I think, true in cardiology, is that, you know, a lot of times we focus on these advanced therapies. But advanced therapies are such a small part of the you know, pool of patients with heart failure, less than 1%, that we, you know, forget that, well, 50% of your heart failure patients have PEF. So these are patients you don't even have any, you know, oral therapies for that can modify their disease course.
Explain HFpEF for our listeners who may not be familiar. So like me, we didn't have HFpEF when I trained.
Yeah, we had diastolic heart failure, but right, that's exactly. All gone out. So just a brief primer. So heart failure is a clinical diagnosis of a condition in which essentially the heart is unable to meet the needs of the body. Traditionally, when heart failure was essentially characterized by patients who had reduced ejection fraction. Ejection fraction is essentially how hard your heart is squeezing, and if that squeeze becomes limited, and that's assessed by echo or other imaging modalities, then you have what's called HFrEF, which is short for heart failure with reduced ejection fraction. This is the group of patients, every time we have all these heart failure therapies, we have a bonanza of treatments for these patients that can modify their quality of life and their survival. So we have medical therapies, we have devices such as defibrillators and other types of, you know, special pacemakers. We have, these patients are candidates for left ventricular assist devices, and so on and so forth. So these patients have a plethora of interventions that we can give that can really, you know, make a huge difference to their overall outlook. But then what we've seen is over time, about half of our patients with heart failure, these are patients who are relatively older, who have more comorbidities, have preserved ejection fraction. So they have clinical heart failure, but their heart squeeze is not the issue. It's just that their heart becomes stiff. And these are patients from home. None of the traditional things that I've already mentioned, like ICDs, like medications, like LVADs, have really any proven rule to, you know, change their, you know, their quality of life or their survival. And so you would think that, oh, this is a group of patients that have a highly symptomatic condition, that have multiple medical comorbidities, and often in older individuals. So this would be a perfect population that would benefit from a palliative care intervention. And yet we've known that these patients are even less likely to get palliative care referrals than patients with reduced rejection fraction. And in fact, when I mentioned earlier that, you know, physicians are very bad at assessing prognosis, they're especially bad in assessing prognosis in patients with preserved rejection fraction because, you know, and one of the tips that I give in that paper that was briefly mentioned is that, you know, a lot of times when we look at these heart failure patients, we look at their rejection fraction and we think, oh, this patient is a low rejection fraction. Oh, that patient is going to do much worse than a patient with a normal ejection fraction. Yet, if you look at the studies, what it shows is that ejection fraction is not prognostic at all. In fact, in older individuals with heart failure, the survival of a patient with HFpEF is essentially the same as the survival of a patient with HFrEF. So ejection fraction, even though is such a central sort of, you know, way that we get a sense for, you know, what's going on with this patient with heart failure, it actually doesn't inform us when it comes to getting a sense for how sick they might be or how much time they might have left.
And on the question of prognostication, are there any models that you use? Like, how do you prognosticate?
So I use something very basic. I will ask myself, would I be surprised if this person were to die within the next 1 or 2 years? I use kind of both 1 or 2 years. I give myself that wiggle room, and certainly, and there's some recent data to suggest that this question is not as you know, useful in patients with heart failure as it is with, say, cancer, but it is better than what we have. The things I look at that I think are really, really important when it comes to getting a sense for how, if this patient is truly sort of, you know, approaching the end of life, so to speak, is recurrent hospitalizations are a big one. A lot of times these conversations start in the hospital, and as much as we'd like to live in an ideal world where we didn't have these conversations or in the hospital, that is really where I think most patients are really thinking about these and most physicians are activated and we have the resources to actually deploy. So recurrent hospitalizations is one. Inability to tolerate guideline-directed medical therapies. So a lot of our patients are on medications for heart failure like beta blockers or ACE inhibitors. And these patients have had high blood pressures for a long time. And then, you know, sometimes we see that, oh, the blood pressure is getting lower and these patients start to come off their medications. And sometimes people feel like, oh, that's a good thing. But a lot of times that's actually a really bad sign. When a patient with heart failure starts to have low blood pressures and cannot tolerate the medications they used to be able to tolerate, super bad sign. And it's a red flag in my book. Renal, the kidneys are really, really very closely tied to the heart. So worsening renal function or really any type of worsening end organ function, such as you start having you start developing cirrhosis, you have worsening pulmonary hypertension, worsening renal failure. The other thing I notice is cardiac cachexia. So basically a lot of patients, you know, a lot of these patients, it can be come in volume overloaded. So they'll have big legs, big bellies, and yet they are malnourished. So they may not look like the classic malnourished patient we think about, but that happens very frequently. And one of the reasons it happens is because a lot of these patients with heart failure, they hide fluid in their belly. So their intestines, their stomach, they're engorged with fluid. So they have very, very low appetite. So even though it may look like their weight is going up, but their muscle mass is going down. When I start seeing that, I am very worried about a patient. So I always ask about appetite. I always get a sense for what their mental status is like, because a lot of time confusion, cognitive dysfunction can be a common presentation for patients who are approaching sort of more end stage like heart failure. And then obviously if we're running into situations where a patient may need, we're thinking of things like inotropes, et cetera, that's definitely a big red flag. So those are some of the things, you know, just to reiterate: recurrent hospitalizations, worsening end organ dysfunction, cardiac cachexia, essentially malnutrition, anorexia, needing inotropes, those are some of the sort of an inability to tolerate heart failure therapies because of low blood pressure. These are some of the big things. When I start seeing those, I start to become concerned about a patient.
Yeah, I always think with recurrent hospitalization, there was a study from like over a decade ago, and it's the only one I've seen where it didn't just look at like your first hospitalization, but it split recurrent hospitalization and the decade of age that they were in. So those who were like younger than 65, like you can have one or two, multiple repeated hospitalizations, and they still may do okay. Versus like the 85-year-old, when they're in their second hospitalization for heart failure, that's an incredibly bad prognostic sign. And then we often see this as like, we tune them up in the hospital, we discharge them thinking magically everything's going to change the second that they go home, but it doesn't. And isn't it right? We've seen pretty significant improvements in hospitalization, in hospital mortality, but really 30-day mortality hasn't really changed much post-hospitalization.
In fact, if you look at a population-wide level, heart failure mortality has actually started to creep up over the last recent years, which is very different from ischemic heart disease, which is still seeing continuous reductions. So, and just another sort of nice sort of tidbit for listeners. So if you have a patient who's older than 65, so the what I'm quoting is from a study that was done of Medicare patients only, and you have a patient who's been hospitalized for heart failure, so not recurrent hospitalization, it's any heart failure, any older patient with heart failure in the hospital, their median survival is 2.1 years. So again, if you're older, that's going to be lower. And if you're on the lower spectrum of the 65 and beyond group, it's going to be longer. But that's a good number, at least in my mind, as an average. And in this group, these are data from the AHA's Get With The Guidelines Heart Failure Registry. And in this group, whether you had low EF or whether you had normal EF, no difference in survival. So one sort of key number that I keep in my mind when I'm teaching residents or interns is to have this sort of 2.1 year number in mind when you have an older heart failure patient. The younger patients, you're right. I mean, they can, you know, heart failure is a diagnosis, you know, a heart failure is a very strange term. Let's just be honest. A lot of patients, when they hear heart failure, they can freak out. They really feel like their heart is failing, even though they might be able to live decades with this condition. So a younger patient with heart failure may have a much longer time and may have to live with this for much longer than some of your older sort of group that you just mentioned.
Yeah, you just brought up a great point that I was thinking about too, which is how we talk about heart failure. You know, some of those numbers of 2.1 years can be kind of shocking, I think, when you first hear it, because for a lot of us, well, speaking to like internal medicine trained, you're so used to seeing like heart failure on someone's problem list, and you don't think of it as a terminal diagnosis the way you think of metastatic lung cancer. And I wonder how you explain that to patients as well too, in terms of, you talk about this in your book too, but thinking about how we explain heart failure and how we communicate what that disease looks like.
Yeah, so, you know, even though, you know, I feel like I'm already becoming like a crusty old attending in the sense that I already have my own spiel when I have a new patient with heart failure. So new patient with heart failure, and a lot of times these patients are relatively young, I tell them that, you know, this is a condition that you may have for life, and you will have peaks and valleys. So you'll have peaks where the condition gets worse, and you'll have valleys where it gets, where it's better, and you almost forget you have heart failure. And my goal is to keep you in the valley for as long as possible. I want to, with medical therapies, with procedures or devices, I want to make sure that I keep you in a sort of that long, stable phase of heart failure for as long as possible. But at the end, you will still have those peaks. And once we get there, we'll see what we can do about it. We may have to make some difficult decisions. And depending on where things stand, those difficult decisions might be some type of, you know, procedure, or it may be, you know, just, you know, intensifying medical therapies. But that's really how I frame it to patients. I don't want to discount the fact that they may eventually get worse from this condition, but I also want to tell them that, you know, if you engage with me as your cardiologist, if you do all the hard things that come with being a heart failure patient, which is to take your medications, watch your diet, exercise, blah, 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 it's a really tough condition, then you may be able to stay in this valley for a long period of time. So that's my spiel when I meet a patient who's had a relatively new diagnosis of heart failure. And the reason I talk about this is because I also want to let them know that this is not a lot of people think of patients, I think they think of heart failure essentially like cardiogenic shock, that the heart is actively failing and that it can cause a lot of distress. And part of this spiel is to offset some of that, but also to let them know that this is not going to be a walk in the park, that this is a hard thing to do, but not something you don't have agency over, but that if you do, in fact, you know, do all these things, that the overwhelming amount of evidence suggests that we should be able to let you live, you know, pretty good life.
So I got a question about, you mentioned medications. I think one of the challenges with medications for heart failure is people are put on so many of them because they all potentially have this, you know, incremental, some of them rather small improvement, whether it be symptoms or quality of life. And one of the challenges we see in our hospice unit is that, you know, they come in we have no idea what they're actually taking at home. They're probably not taking anything. And we just start them on their diuretics and all of a sudden they look great. Maybe we add a little bit of ACE inhibitor for those, like, you know, patients with reduced ejection fraction and they're looking great, but we're not adding like the statins and everything else.
Right.
And sometimes they just graduate because they look fabulous afterwards because they're finally taking their diuretics. When you're thinking about this, especially for like our palliative care geriatrics audience out there, how should we be thinking about these medications near the end of life when symptoms are probably, when we're thinking about symptoms being much more important than adding more days to their lives, how would you prioritize them?
Yeah, I mean, and this is where I think I, you know, it's a struggle where as a heart failure cardiologist, I am, you know, vetted to these medications. These are things that I love. And when I can have a patient on all these sort of heart failure therapies, it makes, you know, it makes my heart flutter, metaphorically speaking. But at the same time, I'm also thinking that, geez, like if this is a patient with a limited lifespan, what is the potential benefit? So there are few medications that we have good evidence for. So statins, you've mentioned, a trial done by Amy Abernathy essentially showed that, you know, discontinuing statins for patients who are seriously ill does not change their outcome. So a statin is one of the first things that comes off, and aspirin is another one. The heart failure therapies are a bit challenging because of something you've already said, that some of these medications can actually improve your quality of life. So again, depending on the situation and depending on how they're tolerating it and depending on how burdened they feel with their medications, if a patient is, you know, starting to become hypotensive and their kidneys are getting worse, et cetera, then I have a low threshold to just say, hey, let's just focus on symptoms. But if a patient is tolerating therapies and is not feeling too burdened by the additional sort of medications, or if they've tolerated a medication for a long period of time, maybe I'll hold off on something like the beta blocker or the spironolactone until later, because, you know, I feel that, oh, this might be giving them some functional benefit as well. But it's a tough call. And I feel like this isn't, again, you know, as we've mentioned, we have not really studied this. We know that stopping heart failure therapies in patients who have, in younger patients whose ejection fraction has recovered, taking away these medications can be bad for these patients, but we really don't know what to do for these patients who are really approaching the end. If you look at hospice patients, for example, I mean, if you're saying that their average survival is 11 days, then yeah, of course. I mean, then yeah. And how much benefit can these medications be giving? And one of the things that we found in that same paper was that, a third of these patients or half of these patients were being discharged to hospice on statins, on their Coumadin or on their aspirin or on their ACE inhibitor or on their metformin. And what to me indicates that even when we discharge these patients to hospice, we just don't know, A, how sick they are. We're not being as thoughtful as we could be with regards to simplifying their medication list.
And can I ask one more practical tip? You had a great article in JPM on tips for palliative care clinicians caring for heart failure patients. We'll include that as a show link. Diuretics. Any tips for our hospice and palliative care clinicians on choosing or dosing diuretics for people with very advanced heart failure?
I would say that diuretics, as far as diuretics are concerned, if a patient is volume overloaded, don't worry about the diuretic. Even in patients who are not sort of on the sort of hospice end, but in general sort of patients you see in the hospital, if we give diuretics to a patient who's volume overloaded and their creatinine goes up, those patients actually do better than the ones whose creatinine does not go up. And the reason is that you gave the diuretic and it actually did what it was supposed to do, which was actually contract the patient. So in fact, you know, get that extra fluid off. And so I have that same type of mentality for patients who may be on the hospice end of things, who we may not be getting labs on. But if a patient is volume overloaded, don't be afraid of going up on the diuretic. And going up on the diuretic means that if you give a diuretic dose, it doesn't work, double it. So if you give someone 20 of Lasix and they're still volume overloaded and they're not feeling better, the next dose should be 40. It should not be 30. And if the 40 doesn't work, try 80. And if the 80 doesn't work, then switch to something else. Switch to something like torsemide, which is much better absorbed through your intestines than furosemide is. For me, I have a very low threshold for if you've exceeded 40 or 60 or 80 of Lasix dose and it's still not working, I very quickly will switch to torsemide because it just works better. And then if that's not working, you know, think of other medications such as metolazone is one that can work very effectively. Depending on what the patient's goals are and what the situation is, you may want to give some additional potassium because it can cause a lot of hypokalemia. But if it is really just for symptoms, then you can just give that medication. It'll make people pee. But I always ask my patient, we had a recent patient who was getting inpatient hospice. I asked him, do you want to get rid of this fluid or not? Because a lot of our patients, they're just so tired of their diuretic, of peeing all the time. And that extra urination causes them a lot of, you know, just discomfort having to go, you know, back and forth to the So I'll just ask them, do you feel like you have extra fluid on? Do you want me to help with it? And if their answer is, yes, I would like to get the fluid off, then I feel like, okay, I can give this patient, I can give them metolazone, I can give them torsemide, I just want to get the fluid off. And so we have a lot of oral options for diuretics that we can use before we have to switch to IV. So I would suggest that in that paper, there's a nice table that and we have a small section on just how to think about these things, because I really feel that, you know, this is, you know, diuretics are very, very, our medications we should be very comfortable with giving, even in a place where, you know, we may not be able to get daily labs or et cetera.
I just wanted to thank you so much for taking the time to meet with us and share all of your expertise. And I think Alex still has some more song to play before the end.
I would like to thank all of you. I feel so lucky to be a small part of such a wonderful community. And being here was just a tremendous honor for me. So thank you for inviting me.
And we have to thank you. You are one of the young, bright leaders, a thought leader, a public intellectual, a remarkable combination of a cardiologist, you know, with a strong interest in palliative care, and a terrific writer, writing in the Washington Post about should we change the name palliative care, writing for the lay press with your books, and writing research articles in big journals, in palliative care journals, really a leading figure in the field. So thank you so much for joining us, Heather. Really appreciate it.
Okay, Alex, let's hear it.
This is where my Urdu falls apart. Yeah.
That was fabulous, Alex. I like how you just put yourself out there. Heather, thank you again for joining us today. It was awesome having you. Same thing, Anne.
Thank you, Anne.
And to all of our listeners, thank you for supporting the Jerry Pell Podcast. Again, if you have a moment, please share this podcast with 10 of your closest friends or colleagues. And thank you, as always, to Archstone Foundation for your continued support. Good night, everybody.
Thank you.